pleasant day to everyone. We are BSIT students from ICCT colleges in Kaintarisan. Our group will present on how to assemble and disassemble a system unit, installing Windows 7 operating system and the basic troubleshooting on hardware and software. We are going to demonstrate the disassembling of a system unit, but before we do that, let's test first the system unit if it's working. First, plugging the power cord on the socket. Then switch on the AVR system unit and the monitor. And wait until the desktop display in the monitor. You can see that the desktop display in the monitor. It means that the system unit is working and functioning. Now, we're about to disassemble the system unit. But we have to consider first the safety guidelines in performing disassembling and assembling the system unit. Here's how. First, unplug the power cord from the wall socket before touching any components. Failure to do so, it may cause severe damage to the motherboard, peripherals, and other components. Second, to avoid damaging the motherboard components due to static electricity, never place your motherboard directly on the carpet or the linen. Third, touch both of your hands to a safely grounded object or to a metal object such as time power supply case. Fourth, hold the components by the edges and do not touch IC sleeves or connectors or the other components. Fifth, place components on a grounded anti-static pad or on the bag that came with the components whenever the components are separated from the system. And last, ensure that the power supply is switched off before you plug in or remove the power connectors and expansion cards on the motherboard. Now, we proceed to the demonstration of disassembling system unit. First step, discharge yourself by touching the back of the casing of the system unit. Next step, familiarize first the location of the screw. Next step, unscrew and remove the cover of the casing. Next step, familiarize, visualize, and memorize all the components, hardware locations, cables, and connections. Eighth step, remove all the cables and power connection of hard disk drive. the DVD drive. The floppy disk drive, but this system unit doesn't have a floppy disk drive, and the other cable connectors must remove. Next step, remove all the expansion cards in the memory module. Then step, remove the hard drives. CD and DVD ROM drives. Next, unscrew and remove the CPU pan. Then unscrew and remove the motherboard. Lastly, remove the power supply. now I'm going to introduce the parts and functions of a system unit. First, the power supply. It is a hardware component that supplies a power to a computer to change alternating current from a wall socket to low voltage direct current to operate the processor and peripheral devices. Next is the motherboard. The motherboard is also known as the main circuit board. It connects and communicates to all the devices and components attached to the motherboard, also facilitates the communication of devices with each other. This is the memory module, or the RAM. It is the main memory of the computer. The temporary store of memory, which means all the information stored in RAM will be lost once the computer is shut down. CD-ROM. CD-ROM is the place on a computer where a compact disc can be held, read, and played. CD-ROM drives can open documents and data, CDs, such as music files, pictures, Word documents, and other files. The IDE cable. IDE cable is used to connect the CD-ROMs and IDE. Hard drives. This is a permanent memory where it does not lose the data recorded on it when computer shuts down. Unlike RAM, it can store hundreds of times more data than RAM. The SATA cable. The SATA cable is used for connecting host bus adapters to mass storage devices such as hard disk drives and optical drives. And last is the CPU pad. CPU pan is attached together with the heat sink on the motherboard. CPU pan is used to prevent overheating of the processor in the motherboard. First step, attach the power supply on the system unit and screw it. Next, attach the motherboard and screw. Attach and screw the CPU pan on the motherboard. Next, attach and screw the CD-ROM and DVD-ROM drives. then attach and screw the hard drive. Next, insert the memory module on the memory slot. Connect the cables of hard disk drive. Lastly, cover the system unit.
We will begin with the installation of Windows 11. Let's start using USB as a bootable device.
will now proceed the basic troubleshooting in hardware and software. First, turn on the system unit. Let's test the mouse and keyboard if it is working. As you can see, the mouse cursor is not moving and the keyboard is not working when I move the mouse and tapping the keyboard. Let's see the back panel of the system unit if the mouse and keyboard are connected in the right connection.
Now, let's test the system unit.
After you have logged on the Windows 7 for the first time, we will now proceed to troubleshooting the software. You will see similar desktop to the image below. At this point, you can start using your computer, however, it may not be fully configured. You need to make sure that all the hardware is detected correctly and necessary device drivers are installed. This can be done from the device manager. To go to Device Manager, click Start Menu, then Control Panel. Click System and Security, Systems, and Device Manager. You can choose to search automatically for updated driver software or browse my computer for driver software. Then click next. Finally, check if you have successfully activated Windows 7. Click Start Menu. Control Panel and System Security. Then click System. You will get the window similar to the image below. Towards the bottom, you will see Windows is activated followed by your product ID.
This troubleshooting show how to retrieve the hidden taskbar. First, we go to my computer and then control panel. And then click the appearance and personalization. And then the taskbar, customize it. Click the auto hide. And then you may apply or okay. But now we click okay. And then there's how it shows.